So let me tell you the story about how I met Apoor. We were batchmates, right? Over 20 years ago at IMM, the bar. Then, oh my God, now I know why you've done this. Because we spent 2 years in a campus with 20 women and 200 men. That's why. So of course, because it was 20 women and 200 men, Apoor was one of the men, and sort of I knew he was there and he existed, and we chatted a couple of times, but it wasn't more than that. And I think over the last 20 odd years, we've passed each other, we've met, we actually spent some time in Russia together, and you know, he was this ordinary corporate, reasonably successful, but you know, so many people are type. And then one day, I think he joined a music company and suddenly became interesting. Yeah. And then 2 years ago, we had our 20-year reunion, and that's where we got chatting. And at that time, he just released his first book, which was called 18 Plus. And it was this book of, you know, as my boss put it, naughty stories, Rachna. What are you doing with this book? So. And so it was interesting, it was exciting, it was also very daring. And I remember a lot of us, the women batchmates there saying, yeah, you know, we also have other authors in our batch who write about fairly serious stuff, so Apoor pretty stands out. And anyway, so you know, since then we were meeting, and then one day he calls me and tells me, would you like to be part of this project? And I think the last 18 months or so have been the most exciting sort of and times that I've had. So this is 18 plus duets. And I said, as I said, his true motivation is having been stuck in a place where he was in the, you know, not visible with very few women around. He's now co-written this book with 18 lovely women. A couple of my co-authors are here. And that's what they're going to talk about.
I can see Rachna taking revenge back for all the bad.
Thank you, Rachna. Thank you so much. 18 co-authors. Wow. I know. Which I think we need to, of course, I think do this all over again and get 18 of them in the room and bring every story out. But I'm going to jump straight into the title and what transpired to get here, and I.
No, so I'm one of those idiots, like I said, who always wanted to retire early. So I knew at the age of 24 that I will retire early. I'd worked for a year in Procter by that time. And when I joined my last company, this was Saregama HMV, I was CEO there, we were producing movies, etc. I told Sanjeev Goenka, who was my boss, this is my last job. The parting was a bit sudden, and a journalist called me up the next day to say, sir, what are you going to do next? And without any thought, I just said, I'm going to write. So that's the first thing that I did. I released 18 Plus. Now, what do you do after you've kind of scandalized everybody, as Rachna pointed out? And there's 8 published authors in my batch in IMA. I mean, there are people, Rashmi Bansal, most of you would have heard of, right? So she's my batchmate. She writes very serious stuff. She calls it social work. And jokingly at my reunion, I pointed out even I'm doing social work in a different way. So there's lots of serious people. And what do you do next? You know, what's next? And one day this thought came, how about trying to get women to get involved in this project? In my book and with everything we do, everything has to be 18. So the task became trying to speak to 18 women and say, bhaiya, sex ke baare mein likhenge. So that was not an easy conversation. We've had a revolving door with, I think, 75, 80 women committing, walking out of the project. I've had husbands call me, family members of the women call me at different points saying, what are you up to? What's this? She can't do this. She can't do that, etc., etc. So I really mean it. All the gray hair that I have has been last 2 years, this book.
I so. Don't see many, though. Wow, super cool. Urjita, yeah. So let me go back to the audience first. How many of you know people who are chosen sexologists in their professions? You know, a few? I didn't know anybody until I met her.
Yes.
And tell us about your professional story, you know.
Okay.
One, where did it all start? And of course then, you know, how did Apoorv convince you?
No, he didn't have to convince me. So the first thing I would like to basically ask you, can you just add one more word in this tagline of yours? Work-life balance and what it is? Bank.
Like bank balance.
So work-life bank and sex balance maybe?
Oh, yeah. Done.
Because people do actually deduce sex from their life, and that's what I like to add in back into their lives. Sexology is a tough profession that way, and I happened to choose this profession out of my choice, and not like this was the only thing left. And basically, I am a homeopath, and I deal with sexology and psychiatry with homeopathy. So it is really difficult, because you get raised eyebrows when you say that I am a sexologist, and people really don't want to own you after that. Like some of them really. And some of them, they are like nice people, I would say. They would brag about you that this is my friend and she's a sexologist. So, that's how it's been 11 years that I'm practicing into this field. And trust me, it's really weird when you actually look into society and the problems they have. And it's really good. It's a social work, truly, yeah. And meeting with Apoorv, it was like backdated. Now, 2 years back, I guess, that was in PILF. Yeah, PILF. So yeah, exactly. So I was just roaming around in PILF and I like reading and writing. So I was just there and I was just passing by this room and I heard word sex. And I was like, this is something related to me. And I walked into the room and there was this guy sitting among like three females. I just noticed this one. And I was sitting right in the middle of the room and he was reading one of his stories. That was really interesting. So I really wanted to buy his book. So I went to the stall. But to tell you very frankly, even though I am a sexologist, the book cover page that the cover page that the book had, it was kind of explicit for me as well. So I just went there, came back like three times, and finally I bought it. Okay, and then we met on the Facebook, and that's how we got connected. He just asked me one day, would you like to write the story about maybe sex and humor? I was like, okay, fine. And I didn't show my excitement, obviously. So I took like 2 days or 3 days to revert back on that. And finally I was in the project and it had been really a fun drive so far.
Wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to definitely come back to, you know, the chapters and the making of it.
Sure.
But let me talk to Bhavna first. And so a writer anyway, right? So this is really up your alley. You knew Apoorv from earlier?
No, not really. I met Apoorv last year.
Oh, you met him last year?
That's right.
And how did you get involved in the project?
Okay, so I moved to Pune about 3 years ago, and I didn't have a life. My daughter, who's in the room here today, put me on something called Tinder to make friends. And that is where I met Apoorv Nagpal.
How cool is that?
And he was one of the first people that I actually met off Tinder, because everybody else, since we know what the app is all about, right? It's a dating site. I wasn't comfortable. Of course, I was not looking to cheat on my husband or anything. I was just there wanting to make friends. Where does a housewife make friends? So Apoorv was one of the first ones I actually met, and we kind of hit off instantly. And after a few get-togethers, he asked me, told me about the project, and he says, why don't you write? It was something up my alley. I was absolutely convinced that I'd do this, but I kind of, you know, made excuses. Okay, let me think about it. Let me talk to my husband. Let me see what my daughter says. And then I came back and told him that, it's exciting. I'd love to be a part of the project. And here we are today.
Wow, super cool. I know. We love Tinder. By the way, how many of you have checked out Tinder? It's a great app.
Yeah. Lot of nice people out there. Lot of nice people.
Yeah. So, I know some of you are wondering what the project's all about. Apoorv's been kind enough to put together a little piece around the project really. Can we have a look at that?
So there's three sets I'll play at different points during this talk. This is set one. That's our cover, by the way. The book is out for sale at the end, and we'll be around to sign some if you're interested at around the first break, 11:45. So that's cover, 18 plus duets. Move it, Manoj. Yeah. So these are the kind of quotes that we are doing. So we call them love bites. And you can see these, we'll be putting this up as, actually our website was supposed to launch tomorrow and we were not going to do anything prior to that. But then when Sairi called, just couldn't say no. And we drove down all the way from Pune today early morning.
This is for the SHEROES. Give yourself a big round.
Because I've actually really loved what she does. And we've connected on Twitter many times. First time we met. So yeah, we're doing love bites. So we use that hashtag for this. We put up quotes from different people over here. And this is a little teaser volume.
So cool. I love the fact it says arouse the mind and the body will follow.
Yeah.
So exciting.
And Asha and I are really into limericks. So Asha is one of my co-authors from Pune. She hates being called the oldest member of a group. She's 49 and she's going to kill me for telling you that. But and the youngest one, by the way, is 24, so about half the age. So it's a really good variety of women. And we are both Asha and I are very much into limericks, so we've actually helped each of the co-authors create one, and so you saw six of them right now.
I love limericks too. And by the way, I have to tell you, you've got everybody's Twitter handles on your desks. I've been following Apoor for a while, and I think he's got the sauciest, coolest, and I think the most bold content on my timeline, and I really enjoy it. It's absolutely spunky, you know, the kind of thing that you want to make your day, really. And I guess that's the sense I get as I talk to you guys more and more, that one, you've definitely had a lot of fun doing this, right? And yeah, and I'm sure people are going to enjoy reading it, but let me get into a serious writing question. You know, there's this news which said Chetan Bhagat's new book is coming out, right? The Indian girl,
one Indian girl,
right? And he claims to say that he's written it from point of view of a woman, right? I don't know if that's even possible, but given that you've co-authored, you know, and with 18 women, 18 chapters, very different perspectives, what's your take on something like that?
So I'm I think you may love Chetan's writing or hate it, you have to give the guy credit, right? In the sense of he has taken English fiction in India to a totally different level. And by the way, he sells as much as the next 100 authors put together.
Okay?
So you have to give that guy credit for taking writing where it has. Most people in India today, because of him, in no mean feat, are inspired to write and share their stories.
Yeah.
Now, you may like it.
Also read. People got reading.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So he's taken it to a different perspective. I loved some of his initial work. I know him now reasonably well. I was the first Bollywood guy, I was working with Saregama at that time, to approach him for movie rights to two states. So this is before he became famous. And I had gone, I met him 3-4 times at that point. He was very sweet, called me sir because I'm 3 or 4 years a senior. I think off late, I don't enjoy his writing as much as I did in the initial stages. And I don't think I could ever be so presumptuous to write on behalf of a woman and say that I'm writing from that perspective just because your journey is so different. I mean, I think the way a woman thinks, what she experiences, what she's been through are so totally different to a guy, especially in a very patriarchal society like India, that I don't think I could ever really be able to come up with deep enough insight from a shallow perspective always, but a deep enough insight into that, not me. And that's why, in a sense, I took the easy way out, by co-opting 18 women and working with them instead.
Super exciting. Let me ask the audience, how many of you want to write or have aspirations to publish, aspirations to be called an author? Most of us. Look at this room.
So we've actually self-published.
I know that. I was going to ask you that. So when I got talking to Rachna, one of the things that I learned was that these guys got together and did it all by themselves. They did not wait for a publisher to sort of anchor the project. And I thought that was, I mean, this is bold into many X going out there. And I think what you're doing at the end is, to me, I think this most significant message is you're breaking every stereotype. You're breaking every kind of stereotype in the process. But self-publishing, really? That's what gave him the gray hair.
No. Anyway, so in one of the things that I do now post-retirement is I teach at my alma mater.
Please don't call yourself post-retirement. I can't digest it.
No. Retirement is that I do what I want, when I want, without regard to money. So that for me means I...
Do you like the sound of that? How many of you? So,
and I'm one of the idiots, like I said, who actually went ahead and did it at, I think I was 40 or 41, somewhere in that range when I took this step. It was planned. I remember meeting my wife for the first time and telling her I'll be retiring at early, you know. I teach innovation at IIM Ahmedabad. That's a course that I've developed from scratch. It's a very popular course amongst the students. I've been teaching it 2 years now there.
So I'm very much into innovation. And my first book was published by Rupa, who's one of the largest publishers in India. They really liked it. It's done very well, by the way, fourth reprint just 3 months back. We get along well. But honestly, when I step back and I look at what they do and what they keep,
And I have a very strong commercial background. You know, I've sold to stores, I've done stuff. So I just don't see the point. And I think the publishing industry can do with a good old shake-up, in India especially.
Wholeheartedly agree.
And they are inundated with manuscripts. If you and I were in their shoes, you'd probably behave the same way, by the way. So it's not that they're doing anything wrong or they're being mean or anything. It's just, I think they're stuck in a different era. I recently met a guy from India Book Distributors, one of the largest distributors in India. But again, in 5 minutes, you can sense that aapki to strategy galat hai. Aap stores mein dalenge hi nahi. Kya keh rahe hain aap? You know, he talks like that because I don't see why. Most of you would take a publisher because of either self-assurance, in the sense you want to know that somebody likes what your output is. I already have that. My first book was chosen by Rupa. It's done well. I don't need that reassurance again. B, you can hire an editor. You can hire someone who can give you very candid feedback. Next reason why most of you take up a publisher is you want distribution, correct? You would want your book to be seen at stores. Now, when you think of distribution, you imagine yourself when you get that deal, you think of 10 books being stacked up at the store, having your thing up there, etc. That ain't gonna happen. Do you know what the stocking norm for, let's say, Rashmi or Chetan's first two books are at, say, a Landmark or Crossword? How many copies does each store keep? Any guesses? So I think she put up her name, her hand and said two, that lady over there. The number is 2.1. That's the stocking norm.
Wow.
For Chetan, first two books, or Rashmi, or anybody of that, I mean, Anuja Chauhan, Ravi Subramaniam, etc. So when I checked my stocking norm, at the end, it was 1.3. And that's when you think, but excuse me, matlab, what? And that's my perspective, that anyways today with the Flipkart and Amazon, and we've listed our books on these stores, my perspective is, I don't need these guys. I really think there's a way to do it without being in the control of, say, a publisher, etc. Half my marketing ideas for the first book were shot down by the publisher, who was scared of legal issues. And this time, we are going whole hog. So we are actually India's, I think, most ambitious self-published project so far.
Wow, so cool.
We are, normally with publishers, you're not allowed to talk numbers, but there are probably only 15 authors in India who have a higher print run than our first print run. We've printed 10,000 copies.
Very cool.
And there's, so that's up. It's up on for sale on Amazon, Flipkart, and like I said, some outside right now.
Very exciting. So I totally resonate with, you know, what you're saying, working with publishers. I'm writing my first book with a co-author and same story. So, you know, so maybe I'll get a stock value of 1.2 or something. I guess. Very interesting. I'm going to come to you, Urjita and Bhavna, and back to you, Apoorv, on, you know, getting this whole piece together. And one of the stories we hear a lot from our community is getting families involved. You know, the story behind the story, there are many dynamics to manage. I think one dynamic is your own personal commitment, which is, the assumption it's sorted. What are the other things one got to navigate or needed to navigate, not only for you, but also for your co-authors, women from, who had to sort of put their byline, put their author credentials out there on something that's considered bold or saucy or spicy?
Yes, totally. Family is something that we have to deal with. When you are writing something called as, on this genre called as sex and humor, it's not erotica, it's sex and humor, but people don't understand the difference in between. And for me, what I did is, my husband was not here when he approached me, so I just sent him a mail, and I was like, honey, I'm doing this, and I'm doing this, bye, that's it.
FYI.
So, yeah, so, for the rest of the family, now they have digested this fact that I'm a sexologist, I keep on doing this thing, this is my bread and butter, morning, evening, so if I'm doing something, and I actually approached them as, this is a project that I'm doing, and it is an interesting project, and now that our launch and everything is coming up, I have actually told them the entire thing, explained what it is all about, and yeah, now they don't have any option than supporting me, so yeah, that's how it goes. Yeah, but then yeah, to be honest, that was the story, and yeah, there is like, as Apoorv really said rightly, that we had like a lot of females coming in first place to join in as co-authors, and then they backed out. And they don't want to reveal their names. They want to write under a pen name. So there are a lot of factors. I think, Bhavna, would you like to highlight on this pen name thing?
Well, frankly, it's not accepted in our society that women are writing about sex as yet. So, of course, a lot of the writers have faced flack from their families and societies that they live in, and have chosen to stay anonymous, some of them, not all of them, because Apoorva's entire idea was that we have to be bold enough to put our names on our stories. And I've been lucky among the lot. I'm actually just a very strong person. So my husband really didn't have an argument when I told him, okay, this is what I'm doing, please sign the check. Okay. So Whereas others, I think, you know, Apoorva is better equipped to answer on behalf of them because he knows all of us personally. So I'd hand over to you.
So first, forget the other women. My dad. When I first presented, so I, you know, sometimes we get carried away. Sex for guys also in India is a problem. And again, I had to try to point out, as Urjita said, the difference between porn and erotica and this. I mean, so my dad lives in a different era, which is the world of Thomas Hardy and P.G. Wodehouse. And, you know, so when the first book came out, I told him about it just 1 week before it was due for social media break. Because I think back of the head, I had something, ke kuch hoga. He flipped. Yeah. The cover has these naked legs, basically. And then I told him what it was about. And he went ballistic. And my dad's one of the calmest, sweetest, coolest people. You know, bete, you're IMA. You were CEO. Your children will get expelled from school. You're, you know, is this even legal? So I had to kind of take him through. He imagined Shiv Sena coming and doing dharnas outside my house. He thought, you know, he imagined the worst scenarios. And my wife, who had been so supportive, had read every story, etc. Unka dekhe, moment he brought kids in, she flipped as well. We haven't thought of this. What are you going to do? Stop it, stop it. So, I mean, that's that story. Now, with this book, with the women, the excuses that I've had for backing out after having written story, after having stayed on the project for 1.5 years, I'm going to get married. This will ruin my prospects, as if you figured that out just now. Then my husband doesn't like it. He doesn't like my story. My mom-in-law is having a surgical procedure. This may tip her over the top. There's not even one iota of exaggeration here, please, okay? And if you think this is funny, think about me, who's like getting, I think 3 times in the group I've announced, Rachna will know more, 18 women done, sorted, and then I think 6 times we've had to go back and find somebody else to fill in for another sort. My daughters are going to get married, so I can't do this. I mean, this will ruin their prospects. In our group, by the way, we've had 2 divorces during the period of this book.
Okay. Not because
Not because of the book, but during this period. We've had deaths in the family. We've had, oh, you've no idea what that journey has been.
So. I think maybe you need to write about writing the book itself.
It's coming. The making of.
I know. I want to share something here. So there's this lady called Cindy Gallup, and if somebody's tweeting, please tweet to her at Cindy Gallup saying we're having this conversation. She's based in New York, you know, and one of the trends in investing, VC investing or angel investing now is, so there's this whole story of sex tech, okay? And essentially, and within the SHEROES community, we have at least 4 or 5 women running very bold projects. One of them is called Love Treats, which basically sells basically things that you need, sex toys, condoms, lingerie, all of that. There is Love Cycles, which is a women's menstrual app. There is Love Doctor, which is now part of SHEROES, and basically spoke about mental and sexual health to youngsters and women and everybody else. So I think the conversation is widening. On Cindy Gallup, she set up this platform called Make Love Not Porn to really make sex realistic and put out a non-inflated version of the story in minds of youngsters, in minds of teenagers, in minds of, you know, the whole porn industry, because I guess somewhere the line blurs, and there's also a lot of inflation of ideas, right? It's basically not represented, and there's a whole generation whose idea of sex is very different from what it really is. And did you see that in the stories that you played out?
Yeah. In fact, one of the stories is actually, forget, I'm saying porn is different. I mean, there you expect the pizza delivery girl to be doing stuff, right? Yeah. So, I mean, that's a completely unrealistic world. But in fact, one of the stories we have is with actually a Mumbai-based co-author who couldn't be here, Manali, the youngest of our lot. And there it talks about how sex is actually different from even what you see in normal movies. Yeah. So even mainstream movies, I mean, How many of you have actually tried to have sex in the shower? And is it easy? So the point is, what you see up there, I mean, the Mile High Club. I mean, how many of you have tried that? Okay, so these situations are seen and it seems so cool and there's nice music playing and rose-tinted filter, and in reality, sorry.
It's like love in real life. There's no background music really.
Totally.
Great. You know, I've been hogging all your attention. I really want, the audience to also get a sense of this conversation. Does anyone have questions, comments that you want to bring in at this stage? Shuchi, I'll give it to you. Can we get a mic across to Shuchi there?
Hi, Apurva.
Hi.
Okay, so I've been told not to use the word struggling. I'm an upcoming author.
Excellent.
Which means I have a MSS ready, but no publisher.
Okay.
So you're going your own way. Wonderful that you managed Rupa the first time and you're not going that way now. What would you say to somebody, one who doesn't have 18 women and himself, and the network, also who does not have the Rupa backing the first time, which you can put out, and also somebody who's not from IMA, maybe ex-Larai, and maybe with 3 years of work experience instead of 10.
Good enough, yeah.
And not got anything to do with Saregama or any remotely possible entertainment industry. So sitting in your house, on your laptop, in your wee hours, finishing the MSS, and now it's out there, and now what to do with the baby?
It's out there, meaning you want to put it out there.
That's right. Yes, okay. Out there as in the womb. Yes.
Yeah, done. So my perspective is it's actually very simple now to take the next step. For me, the first step is actually, so I have these friends who will have no problem looking at me right in the eye. I've known them for 30, 20, whatever years, and telling me, Apoorv, this is crap. So the first step is, from where I come, is sending it to those right people who read books, have an understanding of the genre that you've written in, and can, like I said, look you in the eye and tell you, theek hai, nahi hai, etc.
Right.
Before my first book, by the way, 18 plus, I had written this is short stories, I'd written a full book.
Right.
And I'd sent it to, say, 4 or 5 of my friends. They actually came back and told me, and when the issues they pointed out, I knew they were right.
Yeah.
So I wasn't being deep enough. I was coming at it more from a film script angle, etc. So I got what they said, and I realized that was... But the one of the stories I had sent to them while I was waiting for their feedback, which is in 18 plus,
right,
that they came back and said, wow. And they said, can you do more of that? Because there's nothing in India like that. There's nothing, I mean, think of it. It's hard enough to make people laugh.
Right.
I'm not only trying to make you laugh, I'm trying to arouse you at the same time.
Not a mean feat, yes.
So
yes.
The point is, have those friends.
Yes.
Second step is then, the easy, no money, no investment step is, publish it as an ebook. Right. You reach out to only the 3-5% people in India who read ebooks. As a starter, it's a great thought, zero investment, and then you figure out how to promote it amongst your network.
Right.
If the response is good, then you write to a publisher saying, look, sold so many copies, these are the kind of reviews and ratings, and take it from there. That's the easy way.
Right.
Otherwise, I have to have a really long conversation with you on how to print and all of that.
Sure, thank you.
Thank you. That's thank really cool.
Thank you.
Two things came out for me in that. So me and my co-author write our book, we actually have a peer reviewer. He's a published author, and every time we finish a chapter, it goes to him for feedback, and he's giving us instant feedback so that we can keep iterating it. And that's really working well, because never published, never written for a book, written a lot of blogs, and it's a very different writing style.
Yes.
I know. Secondly, I tell everybody at the SHEROES community, and I'm telling you again, if you do a project, let's say you self-publish, please reach out to our community team. There are almost 1 million women on SHEROES. We'll tell your story out there and send your link. You never know what transpires.
Thank you.
Great. You have a question there. Right here. Yes, ma'am. Will you please get up? Yeah, we're getting you the mic.
Okay, I don't have a question. I would like to add 2 bits on that. Because when I quit my career as an investment banker, the first thing that came into my mind was writing and publishing. It was not more about writing, it was more about publishing. Because at that time, e-books and online publishing was at a nascent stage. This was about 7 years back. I've done it, been there, seen it, what it is. Like he pointed out, when you go to distributors, they actually told me I was into children's books. They told me, madam, aap ABC kali kitabe kyun nahi likhte? I said, but why should I write ABC 1, 2, 3? He said, madam, aapko samajh mein nahi aa raha hai. Aapke jo working capital cycle hogi, 3 mahine ki hogi. Aapki ek cycle run hote hote, aapke 2 books jab tak market mein nahi aayenge, aapke paas company chalane ke paise nahi honge. So the market is such that writing and publishing are two different things. That is to answer your question. Writing at the end of the day is a loner's job. It comes out of passion. It doesn't come out of a feeling that your book should sell. It should be read and it should earn money. It does not earn money. What earns money is publishing. Publishing today is a social gimmick. You have to know how to sell yourself. Today's world is all about selling yourself. So that is what publishing is. If you want to be an author and publisher, then it might work. If you want to be an author, be happy with writing. That's my 2 bits.
Brilliant. Thanks for sharing that. Great. Sorry? Yeah, we'll take yours. And then I think Apoor's got another clip for us, right? We'll go back to that. And we will definitely try to keep time so that, you know, we've got a great lineup for the day. I'm very excited about the next panel. And we've got Neeti Palter and Sonam Kalra joining us from Delhi after the CXO panel. So, yeah, please.
Hi, I'm Khyati. I have a question for you, Apoor. Since you are, you know...
Who do you have the question for?
Apoor.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Sure.
Yeah? Now, since you are heading innovation and you have been, you know, in the creative industry, working with many genders, you know, obviously there are many genders now, right? So how do you feel that women are different in the field of innovation and creativity? You know, you have been working with so many women, you know, their ideas, their mindset. How do you feel they are different and how do they impact the entire project?
So one of the shocking things that I found when I go back into an IMA now, is that the gender thing has got worse.
It's got worse?
Yeah. So the percentage has gone down. Also, I'm saying, if you don't mind my broadening the question, even diversity has gone down. So, I mean, I'm BCom honors. There was somebody from psychology, eco, et cetera, et cetera. Today, it's 90% engineers, straight. And even take outside the engineers, the rest 5% are science fields from college, etc. So that really impacts then the kind of breadth of ideas that you get. Because we fundamentally are differently wired, right? I mean, so people have keep on asking me, why did you choose to do this with women, right? So if I can answer that, maybe that helps. How many of you can recall a first or second date with someone which you really enjoyed? Anyone hands? You remember a first or second date that you really enjoyed with somebody, right? Now imagine at the end of that call, at the end of that date, you as a woman would call up your best friend to download everything, right? And most guys would also call up a friend, a mate, to download what was the thing. If you ever heard both these calls, according to me, you would imagine they were two different dates. Agree? Yes? Totally different perspective, totally different things you look at, right? Now, that was the realization that got in my head. And I said, look, I have to do this with women. And my next one, I'm going to try and see whether I can do one with men. You know, we'll call it 18 plus duets, I mean, 18 plus stags or something like that. That we'll see. But this was the, and it has been true. The voices that you see, etc., are so different. And my perspective, it's a sneaky way of bringing my book back in, but it's about innovation. Same thing, you get a very, very different perspective. So in the first year, we had innovated for a Reckitt Benckiser product, And I made sure that the women were distributed amongst the groups. We had one male-only group, and sure enough, you could sense that immediately. Even though the category was right up their street, but you could see that it made a difference. And it does. I mean, diversity per se does. Different backgrounds, different paths, etc. that you've had.
Now you're sneakily talking about the SHEROES agenda. Thank you.
Thank you.
I know, I guess that's how it rolls. But I do want to see that clip because I guess, let's get into the voice of the book because I guess it'll give us a little more, things to chew on. Yeah, can you play the next clip?
Set two. So we are speaking at... This is Pune Lit Fest. They call it PILF. And when I told Manjari, who's the convener, PILF, she's like, Poof, you have a dirty mind. So we're going to do a workshop on self-publishing and humor. This is on 4th. Next one, please. These are some of the things that we're doing for advertising. Is it readable? I think at the back it won't be, for sure. So we're trying to do crazy stuff.
Tell us more, some of that.
This is, we are calling it Duets Faking It. And this is an Obama endorsement of our book. Okay. I mean, he's saying, just to read it out, 18 plus duets has made my final year in office much more bearable. Michelle and I hadn't really gotten up to doing much during our time here at the White House, but ever since reading this, I must say that some of the things we've been up to haven't been quite presidential, to say the least. Okay? So that's the, I mean, I hope this gives you a sense of what the book's about in terms of the tongue-in-cheek humor that we're doing. And next, please. This is our Pune launch invite, and what we're doing with every launch is, we are pairing it with an art exhibition. We've called it Caress. And I'm a huge art fan and collector myself. We've got 18 different works of sensual art done by a mix of professionals and amateurs. I mean, the most famous are, there's a guy called Bijay Biswal. Anybody heard of him?
Yeah.
Bijay Biswal? He's huge now. He's a self-taught railway chief ticket examiner. And he does railway platforms. One of his most famous works is owned by me.
I've seen you post those, yes.
So he's a great guy. He's done two for us. There's Nenad Karadzinovic, who does photography. He's based out of Serbia. He's done a few photographs with us. So stuff like that. We're putting together 18 exhibits for sale as well at every launch that we do. So in Pune, the exhibition will be up. And then in Delhi, our launch is actually at an art gallery. So where she will keep the exhibition on for a week. So that's the kind of innovation that we're trying to bring in. I mean, I don't think anybody's done an art exhibition with the book launch, right? And now I'm going to play a clip. It's a longish clip. I'll just pause it after 2 minutes, I think, just switch it off. Just to give you a sense of what the book is about, yeah?
We'll be right back.
really.
Thank you so much. I think I have a little stomachache already. But this is so cool. All the best to you guys. And I guess you've given a lot of hope to a lot of us aspiring to be authors and aspiring to do some cool personal projects. So good luck to all of you. And thank you for being at SHEROES.
No, but thanks so much, Sairi, for having us. It's a great pleasure. This is the first time we're speaking about the book anywhere and with my co-authors as well. Thanks for creating the time. Coolest shoes, love her shoes, don't you? I mean, by the way.
Thank you.
I mean, so, next book, pakka. Thank you once again.
Thank you, guys.